Welcome, everyone. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick.
And I'm Ian Fitzpatrick, and this is World Footprints.
As you may recall from an earlier interview we did with Johannes Syms from Cape Town, the COVID-19 virus trickled down to South Africa a little bit later than it did the United States and Europe. But when the virus did cross the borders of South Africa, the government was pretty quick to respond.
So has South Africa started to flatten the curve? To discover what's happening, we contacted Voice of America correspondent Anita Powell, who was joining us today from Johannesburg. Anita, thank you for joining us. And how are you doing in Johannesburg?
Thank you so much. I'm doing fine. We're all still observing South Africa's now 35-day total lockdown. A lot of us are in our homes. I'm here in Johannesburg, where the weather has just started to turn cold because winter is coming.
So what has South Africa's response been to the coronavirus?
So as you mentioned, the virus hit our shores, so to speak, a little later than the rest of the world. Our first case was reported March 5th. However, South African officials reacted very swiftly, announcing a total lockdown that began on March 27th. Initially, it was 21 days, then they extended it to a total of 35 days. After Friday, which is the last day of our formal lockdown, we're going to go into kind of a phased easing of restrictions. But make no mistake, I've read this document thoroughly. The stages of the easing don't represent huge changes. We're probably going to go down from stage 5 right now to stage 4. And stage 4 includes a curfew. Stage 4 includes severe limitations on what goods can be purchased, what businesses can be operating. So we're still effectively taking very strict measures to maintain social distancing and keep the virus from spreading.
So has South Africa been successful in flattening the curve?
That's a big question for the president and the health minister, but what I can tell you is that the president has said that so far, and it's very important to just temper this, so far, the lockdown appears to be working. But I think you also have to see that we have at least 100 new cases a day, which is far above the government's acceptable threshold of 90 cases a day, which would allow them to ease the lockdown. So we're still seeing viral transmission in South Africa. But President Cyril Ramaphosa has said unequivocally that the lockdown measure has been effective, but we don't know how much. And the other thing that I think it's important that the health minister has said is there's no magic that will stop South Africa from seeing exponential growth of this virus eventually. Mm-hmm. So right now, I think a lot of South Africans may not understand that this current lockdown is not going to solve the issue. It's just going to delay the issue, which is the point, because it gives our health sector time to prepare for the peak, which may hit us in July or September is what we're hearing.
Mm. Now, how is South Africa dealing with issues such as testing and the PPE that we've been hearing about to protect frontline healthcare workers and other people who are dealing with the public?
Well, I want to tell you some really exciting news, actually, which is that two scientists in Cape Town have come up with a coronavirus test that will only take 65 minutes instead of the standard 3 hours. That test is still in the testing phase itself. You need to test the test to make sure it works. And it should be ready in July, which means we'll have our own, if it works, homegrown testing service. South Africa's health officials have said that they are not conducting enough tests, which is not necessarily for lack of tests. It's for lack of access, lack of information, and just lack of awareness around the risks here. Because, I mean, South Africa, in terms of public health, is a really complicated country. And its health tableau is kind of complicated by poverty, by lagging infrastructure, by communication issues. And so we haven't gotten exactly where we need to be in every South African understanding the resources that are available to him or her. So the testing there could be more testing, but the government does perform far more tests than they get positive results. So far this is quite encouraging that we're conducting quite a number of tests. I believe it's 1,600 tests a day, but I'd need to check that. but we only have about 5,000 cases right now, so.
Mm-hmm. Well, it begs a question. I'm curious how people in some of the marginalized communities are being infected, if there's a disparity in the rate of infection, and then the medical care, because obviously we're struggling with that here in the United States.
That's a very big question. It's also kind of a loaded question in a country with such steep racial divides that fall very neatly, such inequality that falls rather very neatly across racial lines. One thing that is kind of interesting is that we haven't gotten as much data, and I say we, journalists, feel we haven't gotten as much data as we would like on the racial breakdown of infections and of deaths. So there's a small lack there, and we don't understand entirely why. It's probably just officials are really struggling to keep up with the caseload that they have, that they're maybe omitting those details. So I can't answer the question yet in terms of racial disparities in infection. What I can tell you is this. In many, many parts of South Africa, the public hospital is the only healthcare facility available to many residents. Private healthcare is available in the cities, but in the rural areas, we're looking at public hospitals, public clinics, and people often have to go a long way to get to these clinics, wait long, in long queues at these clinics and these hospitals, and that's just going to exacerbate the situation. South Africa has come up with a few interesting workarounds, because I do want to talk a little bit about the innovation and the optimism of this country. One of the interesting workarounds that they've come up with is, as you may know, South Africa has the world's highest burden of HIV. We have at least 7.7 million people in this country who we know about who are HIV positive. And the government runs one of the world's largest ARV programs that provides free medications. But the problem is, if you are HIV positive and you want to be compliant on your medication, you have to go to the hospital or the clinic every few months, stand in a queue, talk to a provider, and get your medication. Even if you're completely compliant, your cell count is low, you are undetectable and untransmittable, everybody has to do this. What they're now doing is they're allowing chronic patients to get 6 months worth of medication at a time. Not all chronic patients, but many chronic patients. So that's going to take a lot of the burden off of the healthcare system, because it allows them to keep those patients out of the clinics and out of the hospitals. Then there's this other cool thing that we're doing now in Johannesburg and Bloemfontein, which are ATMs basically for chronic medication. So you go in and you talk to somebody virtually, just like I'm talking to you now, but only for 3 minutes. And the pharmacist asks you some questions and he says, okay, you're good to go. Here's your medication, and dispenses 2 months worth of your chronic medication. This is for whatever chronic condition you have, but it's being used quite a bit, as you can imagine, by HIV patients. So South Africa is really trying to come up with creative ways to work in this unique dynamic to kind of free up the healthcare system, to strengthen it, and to also care for our vulnerable population.
Does that include the homeless as well, Anita? Because, when you have stay-at-home orders and the only home people know is a sidewalk, I mean, how are those people being treated and protected?
So the government and also private organizations have set up places for people to stay. What they're using right now, quite cleverly, are schools, because schools are closed right now. So just a few blocks down the road from me, we have, I believe, 50 men in Parkhurst Primary School who've been staying there for a while, and the neighborhood has pulled together to donate basic necessities for them. So that's one intervention. Obviously, people are slipping through the cracks. There are a number of reasons, but the government did plan for this eventuality, and they are addressing at least a segment of this population. But I think afterwards, we might see that some people were left underserved and paid a heavy price for that. But we just don't know right now, because all of us are stuck in place.
Yes. So, as a reporter on the street, how are you protecting yourself? Because a lot of people forget that reporters are also frontliners.
Well, we're doing a lot of virtual calls right now, and that is VOA's guidance, because as our director, Amanda Bennett, has said, it's not acceptable for any of our staff to become infected in the line of our work. We're doing everything we can to prevent that. So right now we're doing a lot of virtual consultations, and once the restrictions ease up and the total lockdown ends, we should be able to venture out with PPE. One of the provisions of the eased lockdown is that everybody now has to wear masks in public. So I expect you might see me in coming weeks reporting with a mask covering most of my face. So we are going to have to take those precautions. But what's kind of interesting about South Africa is we also have one of the world's highest caseloads of TB, tuberculosis, highly infectious. I've spent a lot of time talking to patients, in close contact with patients, and I've already familiarized myself with a lot of these precautions. I've also reported on Ebola before in the Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo. So a lot of these precautions and this training that you get from doing that just kicks in. So it's basic hygiene, it's basic distancing, and it is wash your hands, which I say to my four-year-old daughter as often as she'll listen.
Now, individual states here in the U.S. are planning to reopen on different schedules, some in accordance with some of the CDC guidance. What are the provinces and what is South Africa at the highest level doing in terms of planning for reopening the country?
So as the president outlined in his plan, we have five phases. Right now we're in phase or stage five, which is total lockdown. Now every municipality, so every subset of every city is going to be determined by provincial and local officials what stage they need to be. And that's going to be based on infection rate. That's going to be based on a number of criteria. So we could potentially have very remote, very population scarce parts of South Africa that are under a lower level. We don't expect that in Johannesburg anytime soon. This is the epicenter, this very neighborhood where I am in Johannesburg, and just 10 kilometers up the road, which is where the VOA Bureau is, are the hotspots. So we expect to see quite a bit of variation, and that's going to be evaluated regularly by provincial and municipal officials, and they're going to set the level accordingly. But here in Gauteng, which is a very small province, but the most populous, it's home to the Johannesburg-Pretoria Metroplex, which is about 11 million people, I think we're going to be under pretty strict conditions for the foreseeable future.
Mm-hmm. And given that, and given where you guys are, I want to find some happy news and report on some happy news. And so we've seen, you know, in many communities around the world, people coming together, people rallying in support of frontliners and helping neighbors the best way they can. What have you witnessed? What acts of kindness have you witnessed where you are?
I'd like to contextualize that by the guiding philosophy of the people of Southern Africa, Ubuntu. And Ubuntu means I am because you are. Mm-hmm. And so for, I think, the people of this part of the world, this is nothing new. This notion that if I want to help myself, I must help others is very familiar, is ingrained, I think, in everybody who lives in this environment. And so I think we've seen quite a bit of reaching out, but I think a lot of South Africans and Southern Africans would probably laugh and say, that's just what you do. Of course you pay your aunt's phone bill. Of course you send money to your third cousin. Of course you dig through your closet and see what clothes you have that can go to the women at the shelter. Of course you do that. So we have seen that on a micro scale, which I actually think is kind of the ethos of Ubuntu. It's on a micro scale. So it's people helping people on a very interpersonal level. And I think we're seeing a massive surge in that. And what I think it's actually doing for a lot of South Africans who may have been living in a bubble is made them aware of the needs and circumstances of the people in their immediate vicinity who they never gave a thought to or purposely, you know, ignored, perhaps, because it was just too difficult to think about. So I think we're seeing that, but we are also seeing huge donations by titans of South African industry, including the Oppenheimer family, which is a very wealthy family, have donated money to support these large scale programs. Like, for example, some of the large scale programs we're seeing are food parcels for every South African family. But of course, people are falling through the gaps because this is a country of many immigrants. And non-South Africans are not eligible for these food parcels. And so people who might be natives of Zimbabwe, Malawi, Congo, Ethiopia, who are in need, are falling through the cracks. So that's where some private organizations and faith-based organizations are stepping in. So we're seeing a lot, but I don't think it is unusual for this part of the world. This is one of my favorite things about this part of the world is Ubuntu. Is that we care about each other. And if we can see a little bit more of that in the world, I think it would be a better place.
Anita, as we wrap here, what is the first thing that you plan to do or the first place you plan to go once we're past this pandemic?
Okay, so it depends if you ask me or my boss. For me, I'm kind of thinking of Madagascar, the island nation, it just off the coast, off the east coast of Africa, because Madagascar is really having a hard time right now. Madagascar is a very, it's an impoverished nation. They still have bubonic plague. They have periodic weather challenges, cyclones, political instability. It's just a horrible mix of all of the things that ail this part of the world, I suppose. So I think there would be a lot of opportunities if I could go to Madagascar. And I hope my editors are listening because I would like to go to Madagascar. But if you ask my boss, who, as I've discovered working from home, is not anybody at Voice of America, my boss is a four-year-old. She would like to go to Japan and eat all of the sushi. And she would like to eat all of the noodles. And she would like to go see all of her favorite anime characters. And she would like to go to some amusement parks and go to the beach. All in Japan. And so it's kind of a toss up, Madagascar or Japan. I'm not sure. We'll see.
They both sound wonderful, actually. Well, Anita, thank you so much for spending time with us today and sharing what's happening in South Africa. And certainly we will keep in touch and just keep monitor what's happening in the country. But in the interim, you stay safe and be well, and we wish our audience the best of health. And really, guys, don't forget to smile.